And both of them need no introduction, but still, it is my duty. Words, Mr. K. T. Jagannathan, very senior financial journalist, associated with Hindu Business Line Group, and he writes columns in various newspapers and electronic media. And Mr. Nagappan, a familiar market expert, is part of our family, and he is very well known in the investment circles. And the market conditions created by Corona, the lockdown, and the subsequent, distancing, not being able to commute, not being able to travel, has put us into a very difficult situation. It is a challenge that we are facing, and our industry, having been declared as a essential service, we are continuously on the job providing service. And as far as our organization MSAFSL is concerned, I'm very glad to say that we have been able to provide uninterrupted service to all our clients and all the stakeholders. So technology has made it possible. So the same technology we are trying to use to connect with people, to connect with our team, and also to the people at large. So this is one of the first sessions. Last week we had a trial run. This we can say we are making a very sincere attempt to reach out to more number of people by sending mails, messages to clients and various people to provide a platform for our clients and other stakeholders to engage with each other. So in this connection, we are having this webinar. We are going to cover two broad topics. One will be about the outlook on economy, how the economy is going to be affected, or what is going to be the impact of economy, what will be the impact of this disease on the economy. Mr. Jagannathan will be sharing his views and thoughts about that, and the impact of this on the markets. What we have been witnessing for the last, say, 45, 46 days, and also how it is going to unfold in the days to come. Mr. Nagappan will be sharing his thoughts on those lines with us. So, now I will hand over to Mr. Jagannathan to start with his views on economy. How is the outlook and what is the way forward in the days to come? Mr. Jagannathan.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. Hope that you all can hear me. Good evening to everybody. First of all, even before the COVID, there has been a slide in the Indian economy. Even before the COVID, the Indian economy has been on a down slide in the sense, 7% to 6.5%, 5%. But the downslide has already happened even before the COVID. That was coronavirus. Now the prediction is that we are near zero growth rate, something like that. So that is that. So before the virus, the sectors like sector, which is always considered as the drivers for the economic growth, is the automobile and the construction side. So automobile doing well even before the coronavirus, and construction, the housing also is a problem that way. So those are the generally considered as the drivers for the economy. They were also not doing well. So what post corona, what happened is this, come to a virtual standstill in the sense of every country is on a lockdown mode, and India is no exception to that. So what happened is the post-corona, the new sectors, like generally they were doing well before the corona virus. Hospitality and travel business, everything was doing well. Now they were seriously hurt because new things added to the economic force because of the corona. Because these were doing well, and now these were in deep trouble. You know, airline, hospitality, and all that. Even now, what happened is that post lockdown, the continuing lockdown, we don't know how the virus course is taking, and we don't know the finality of the virus itself. You know, when it will end or how will it end, something like that. That being the case, you know, everybody, from you, me, and the authorities, governments, everybody is still figuring out what could be the impact of the coronavirus on all of us, individually, collectively, or nation-wise, and everybody. So the damage is still being assessed. Nobody knows what is the extent of the damage. So that's the one reason why the government is still not coming out with the package. So the market and everybody, experts, economists, and everybody is trying. And the industry, they were all crying for a big financial cycle, but nothing so far. We are still waiting. The waiting game is still continuing, and the government seems to be taking its own time to come out with the financial package. I feel that is justified because we need to understand, you know, the exact impact, exact quantum of the damage that virus has caused to the economy. I believe in the days to come, maybe a week or 10 days, there will be a clarity on what could be the financial package the government is unveiling. So that is the aspect of it. So that is why the market is also seesaw battle in this. So one day it is going up, one day it is coming down, you know, or something like that. Because the market is not quite sure what the government is doing. With a package, something, what would be the component of the package for each sector, something like that. So this is one aspect of it. The other aspect of it is that, you know, but I strongly feel with the entire activity coming to a standstill, nothing is happening. You know, everybody is locked inside the home. And if that is the case, you know, the infections and everything has stopped, you know. So you can ask the industry and the business guys to not to cut send away people, not to cut the salaries. But there is a limit to that. Maybe they can do it for a month or maybe just like that. Or maybe the thing is that, you know, right now, the pocket needs to be filled. The demand is at a very, very low point. Hello? Are you hearing? Hello? Hello?
Yeah, KG, we can hear you.
Yeah, we can hear you.
The best thing, the everybody says from the industry, how do we revive the demand? That's the biggest challenge that the government and everybody faces. The demand needs to be revived. But in the short term, in the immediate term, this can be done only by putting money into the pockets of the individuals. But how can that be done? Nodding, how can they give the salary? Then the onus is squarely on the government. The government should do something by which it helps the common man to have some money so that they can carry on the normal activity. That will do that. So my theory is that like that, the onus of reviving the entire the economy rests squarely on the government. What can the government do? See, the private sector can only follow the government. Unless the government comes forward, the government has to be the front runner for leading the economic growth. So how can they do it? They can do it only by creating the demand. How can they create the demand? My simple solution, my understanding is that the government must invest in infrastructure or spend money. It is not merely spending, just doling out. You can invest, spend money, infrastructure development, road construction, something like that. If that is done, some kind of a activity will be there and some kind of a income generation will be there, and that will automatically create demand. That will trigger further that will trigger the private sector to step in and carry on their activity. So that will have a chain multiplier effect. That is how the current situation, given that the demand can be revived. I remember the John Maynard Keynes, the famous the depression economist, you know, once long ago, he said that, you know, the thing is that, how do you create demand? You just dig up a hole, you know, and then you fill up the hole. At least by doing that, some activity is there and you can create a demand. That is how he prescribed in early days, you know, in the depression days when the demand was at a very, very low level. So taking cue from him, you know, something has to be done to create the demand. The government has to do it. And then it is easier said than done. And again, post lockdown, once the lockdown, we exit the lockdown in a calibrated manner, slow way, things are not going to be that easy. In the sense, you know, so as I see it, the Indian capacity in India across the sector is in excess of the demand, I would put it, even before that. So we have an excess capacity in position. So I don't see the industry is putting more money, more investment into that. At best, they can use up the capacity. That is quite fine, I would say, even that is required. The capacity is not going to be a constraint for us, but the constraint will be in terms of the supply, supply chain. You know, how do you connect that? You know, because of the entire states and everywhere it is locked down. Trains are not running, trucks are not running, buses are not flying, and the private transportation is not. Given that situation, there should be some way out. How do we navigate this without compromising on our safety aspect of it, so that this can be navigated in a safe manner, so that the supply chain is brought back to normality. Normality will take a while, but at least some visible improvement can be done by this. So this government has to do it. But the other point is that, you know, let's say one example I'll give, like Andhra Pradesh, you know, where, you know, the Jagan Mohan Reddy is government has stalled all the investment projects. Construction activities have come down because of the new state capital they were desiring, but that's all scrapped. But now that kind of a situation cannot continue. They will have to do something else, something now to revive it. So they will relook at their own decisions and allow that. Start the constructions to happen. Once that picks it up, you know, a lot of activity will be there. My sense is that, you know, the economy is absolutely bottomed out because we are a zero growth now, you know, but it cannot go any down further, I would put it like that, you know. So you need, it will pick up once the lockdown is out, and then we are slowly back to the activity, something like that, you know. So, given that we have a population size of 130 crores, all of them need to be fed, in the sense, you know, they need to be fed, one, and they need to be clothed, in the sense, two. So, all these demand that, all this suggests that we can expect the economy to revive, I would say. Definitely, it will revive because. India is in a capacity. The capacity is not a constraint. We have good capacity now. So production is not going to be a constraint, only the demand. So given the fact that the India's population is this much size, you know, the size will automatically create some demand. But how do we accelerate the demand? The onus is on the government. So that's what I'm saying. So I'm quite positive we will come out of this, and then things will pick up, one. And again, if you look at the international scene, you know, the anger of these the nation states across the globe is directed against China. So China, whatever you like or you don't like, is perceived to be the cause of this coronavirus, in the sense, you know, they may not like it or something like that. We may dispute that also, but that anger, you know, is going to reflect in the paradigm shift in the way the countries go forward in the coming days, in the sense, like Japan said that it will allow their industries to shift away from China. Whatever be the money, okay, we will fund it, Japanese government said. The South Koreans have said that. The Americans saying that every day, though the trade talks they held, they said that the officials said that it was in a positive way. But then day in and out, day out, the Trump administration is spitting venom on China. A lot of anger is directed at China. So given this the global situation, on India is in a very finely placed, advantageous position to see the some of these industries could come in forward. So going forward, you know, like in a market parallel de-risking strategy, you know, every country will now de-risk. Now they have learned the hard way, the risk of putting all the eggs, all their money in one place, like China. Now they will see that the cost of this kind of a strategy, they were now, everybody is realizing. So they now will, the nation state will now disperse the investment across the globe, so that, you know, they don't get into such a kind of a situation in any future. So that gives an opportunity for the countries like India. So India, we have a talent pool, IT talent is there, engineering talent is there, every talent is there, and then manpower talent is there. So that could really seize this opportunity and do that. So I am not a pessimist, I'm I'm an optimist, in the sense, you know, I see a lot of good things could emerge out of this coronavirus for us. And then again, if you look at it, you know, the corona has redefined the business propositions, and then the business rules could be redefined going forward, in the sense, you know, like social distancing. Social distancing, every companies will now, because of the 40-day lockdown and the corona fear. And it has not gotten out of our mind. Still, we are fearing that if I step out, something could happen. All these fears will ensure that we maintain the social distancing, or it is implemented, whatever, in a strict way. If that is done, then that causes, that brings a whole lot of, first of other opportunities. And this opportunity, we can say, are shaped in the way we do the business, in the sense, you know, like what we do in it is unheard of. I never done a Zoom conference, you know. I was physically present in any meeting. I never been through the internet or something. But this is a very new experience for me. So probably this is going to be a new normal in life, in a sense. So all of us will communicate through this kind of a thing. So what happens is that when you do all this, you know, we need a connectivity. We need a software to carry it forward. We need a hardware to do this efficiently. All this will kind of create a different kind of an opportunity in terms of hardware building, in terms of the new skills we need to understand. As somebody was saying that it is not enough if I have a checkbook, you know. So I should know what is the process of getting the money from the bank. If I'm not educated in the process of getting the money, it is not. It is useless to have a check, you know. So all this requires some kind of a skill development activity will be that all of us will be educated. Online, again, the online courses will be there. I can tell you that, you know, L&T, one of the biggest the conglomerate in the country, you know, they were digital much before this Zoom and all that. I think I had gone to their office in Chennai there. They have they monitor across the globe their activity in different fields across the world, you know, how the trucks are moving, who works, and all that they monitor from this place, you know. So even before that, you know, the digital digitalization has become the new normal, in the sense, you know, so this gives an opportunity. Maybe we were ahead of Corona, they did something like that, but all of us will now follow different things now. So now this will force a different kind of a learning, different kinds of strategy in business, and different kind of an opportunity, I would put it like that, you know. And one more thing I would say that, you know, like the automobile is the real driver for the economy for many, many years. We have seen that. But two theories are there. Now, nobody has some money. So why will somebody buy a car or a motorcycle, something like that? That's one aspect of looking at it. The other aspect of looking at it is that people now say that because of the social distance and all that, and then the scare Corona has really created in the minds of everybody. And people perhaps maybe opt for a private mode of transportation, maybe two-wheel or something like that. So given that, you know, there is an opportunity, you can the glass is off full or off empty as we perceive it. So the business, the automobile companies will see it as a off full, glass is off full. Probably I can see that as an off empty glass. But I'm quite positive with it. All this pan out and different kind of opportunity for us. So, one problem I feel in the new normal era was that the biggest labor or the migrant labor, as you say, you know. See, the migrant labor proved the fulcrum for most of the business activities in the construction side, I would put it like that. Most of the metro projects are across the country, where primarily the creation of this migrant labor, in the sense, you know, they worked hard, 16 hours labor, 18 hours, something like that, you know. So the way, during this lockdown period, the way these migrant, the guest laborers were treated by the states across the country, that will have a psychological impact on them. So most of them are gone back. And then I'm quite, like many states are now pleading with this, the states which from where the migrants come, that please don't take them away. We will keep them here. Something like that. The point is, you know, once the lockdown is gotten over, and once the things are easing up, and these we need to get on with life. The activities, you know, the construction and all that, they were a crucial element for most of the construction activities across the country. And then now the way they treated now. They were all heading to their home states, you know. There is a psychological, I guess there is a psychological impact on their mind, in the sense, you know, if at all I'm going to die, why not I die in my native place with my kids around. So that kind of a psychology, if it gets into the minds of them, it will be very, very difficult for us to get them back to the workspace and workplace, you know. So that's a real, real challenge I see for the business now going forward. In the interim, I feel the cost of labor could be pretty, the labor may not be available in plenty, or the cost of labor will go up. That's the thing, how the business is factoring in that, we need to see. And one more aspect before I wind it up, you know, the sense that the thing is that, you know, what this social distancing has done is that, you know, and social distancing caused by Corona has done is that a kind of a fear. Can I just invite anybody to my home? So that's a problem. So these kind of unorganized skilled worker, maybe a plumber, maybe an electrician, whoever it may be, how do they get into my home? So now there will be a kind of a mental blockade on my part to allow them inside, you know, whether they are safe to entertain, be entertained. So now, the government has to think differently. How do we go forward in this? You know, so there was a suggestion from the experts community that we should now some sort of a licensing of these, registration of these guys, and some sort of a health check for them on a regular basis, so that they can be given a identity card, they can be given a health clearance. We green check green clearance on the health side, so that the households can invite them with no fear or whatever or hesitations, you know. So so this is a new kind of a thing, you know. So a lot of things will get organized, I would put it like that, you know. Get organized, or it needs to be organized. I think these are the larger kind of a thing I see as we go forward. So that's just my, to sum it up, I feel, you know, to sum it up in a philosophical way, in a very philosophical, I would say that these two shall pass away. I'm quite sure this will pass away. And we need to go up, and only go up. And I don't think it is going to go down. I would. Thank you so much. You know. Hello.
Yeah, thank you, sir.
Yes, Swami.
Thank you, KT.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Sundar.
Thank you, sir. Yeah, thank you, Mr. Jagannathan. That was very nice. And there are questions coming up in YouTube also. I'll take the questions after the Nagappan's presentation. Mauli, please follow the YouTube chat. Please note down the questions. And you can ask from there. You can hand over the slip to Mr. Shankar. And the questions can be posed from there.
Okay, now, sir. Over
over to Mr. Nagappan.
Good evening, friends. I'm not going to take a lot of time. 6 minutes very quickly. I'll wrap it up. What I'm looking at from the market, I divided it into 1.5 minutes each of three parts. First, I think the valuation part, whether how the market is valued right now, is it very expensive or cheaper? It has corrected a lot, so is it cheaper or is it a right time to invest? And then if at all we are going to invest, what kind of the sectors to look out for? And then wrapping up comments. So these are three parts which I wanted to tell you, but very shortly, very crisply. We are running short of time, and we can take a lot of question and answer after that. Now, quite a lot of good questions are coming in YouTube and as well as the chat box. I could see that one of the participants was asking us a question that when Indians are performing outside India, why not in India? So it's a good question. So maybe Mr. Jagannathan can answer that later. But as far as the valuation goes, the market is never valued, never trade at a fair value. There are many seniors, you know, Chandru is there, you know, my senior, and a lot of other people are there. So you all know that the market is never, market never trades at a fair value. Market is either overpriced or underpriced most part of the time. And very hard, rarely it trades much closer to the fair value or the price, which happened sometime in March end, probably. This year, March end, it happened. The market was trying to trade somewhere closer to the fair value or slightly cheaper than the fair value. But otherwise, the last 2 years, we're all puzzling that why the market is trading at such high price, very expensive. In spite of, you know, if you look at the valuations, it was very high. Market was continuously going up. And the reason being that in 2019, we received an FII inflow of $14.5 billion. $14.5 billion in the year 2019, entire 2019. And what happened in 2020 in the first 3 months? The entire 14.5 has been taken back by FIIs, or much more than that, $14.69 billion taken back. And that was shown in the market. Market crashed and market fell down. Sensex came down from 40,000 plus to 27,000. And Nifty also came down from 12,000 plus to below 8,000. So on January 23rd, I remember January, third week of January, the Nifty PE was about 28 or 20, more than 28. And price to book of Nifty was more than 3.5, close to 3.5. And the yield, dividend yield was 1.25. These three are not absolute. I will not say that these are the right parameters, but then, in a larger audience like this, when we are discussing it, is, you know, given the constant time constraint, I'm just picking up some broader data points. And if you look at the PE of 28, which was there on January 3rd week, The price to earning ratio of Nifty came down to as low as 17 on March 23rd, from 28 to 17. The price to book value of index Nifty, from 3.5 times, almost 3.5 times, it came down to closer to 2 times. And the yield, which was only 1.25%, it came up by 2, it came up to 2%. 2% yield is a good yield as far as index goes. 2 times book value is very cheap, or reasonably priced, or much lower than the reasonable fair value. And PE of 17 is a little lower than the long-term average of 18 or 18.5. But that was there very, for a very brief period, maybe a couple of days, 2-3 days, then market bounced back. And today, where we are today, again, the Nifty PE is about 21 plus. And the price to book is 2.65 or 2.7. And the yield has again come down from 2 to 1.6. So right now, it's very clear that the entire 2019 Nifty was expensive. Maybe good for traders, but for investors, it would have, you know, better wait, have they waited and invested in the index or Nifty stocks. But for traders, it's a different thing. I don't want to touch upon that. But right now, up to, you know, the index was very expensive till January or even February. But the index became cheaper in March. Now it is neither expensive nor cheaper. So we may have to wait for some more time if somebody is looking at bargain hunting. Now the question is that in the process of waiting, will we lose out good opportunity? Yes, it is possible. A lot of uncertainties are there. So normally the other way we suggest is go for a staggered investment over a longer period of time. But then if you don't mind waiting, I think it is better to wait, because the bounce back which has happened based on the expectation that RBI is going to give something, government is going to give something. These are all the expectations which are built upon, and invariably when the expectation becomes reality, market always comes down. This is basically because of people, we don't understand, or we refuse to understand the first order effect and second order effect. Now, what is the first order effect? The first order effect is I can look at it in two different levels. One is that the personal level, if you look at it, the first order effect is everybody was scared about life on, you know, March end or April, and then they got out of it. Today, nobody is scared of life. I think at least major people, majority of them are not scared of life, but they are worried about economy. This is the second order effect. Similarly, in the markets, if you look at it, the first order effect is that we always look at, where we lose business, hotel or hospitality or all these things. But then the second order effect is that the opportunities lies in those sectors which is affected. For example, now there could be two arguments for the same real estate. We can always say that, you know, I've been telling in a few meetings also that real estate is going to, pick up. Till last year, I was thinking that the real estate will pick up this year end or next year. But then post-COVID, I thought that it may come down. But there is a counter view to this. There is always this market surveys, because there are two different viewpoints. And there is a counter view to this saying that where 300 people are working in office, now 100 people are going to work because of social distancing, which means more space is needed. This is one part. Okay, people may work from home. Now, if people are going to work from home, the other challenge is that if people are going to work from home and with husband and wife working together, I don't think this 1 month stopgap arrangement will be, this kind of method. We have to have everybody will think of having one separate room, an office room at home itself. Those who are living in two-bedroom house will start looking at three-bedroom house, and the difference they save by way of commuting, travel, they may try to pay it as an EMI to acquire that extra bedroom. So real estate requirement can also go up. So we don't know. We have to wait and see how the people's mindset changes, how the earning capacity changes and all. So coming back to the original question, the market is valued. It's not cheap, certainly. It's not very expensive, but it's slightly expensive. And for those who are looking at, who are willing to wait, do the waiting game, it is worth waiting. But then if you have to be judgmental. You cannot be judgmental. In most of the cases, a common man cannot be a judgmental. An average investor has to take a chance. So the other way is to look at staggered investment. Now, having said that, if you're looking at sectors, what kind of sectors? Post-COVID, the sectors which are going to do really very well and extremely well, unfortunately, in my opinion, most of them, or they will be in unlisted space. They may not be in listed space. And so we may have to do the proxy, right? And like education, edutech, technology is going to do very well. And IT, contrary to what many people believe or ideas, it's completely undervalued today. I think that will do very well, or reasonably well at least, in spite of US not doing well, in spite of US the apprehensions are that, you know, we may not get more orders and all. See, the IT, the advantage for IT is that scaling up and scaling down is just like that possible. An automobile company cannot recruit 5,000 people immediately or sack 5,000 people immediately, which an IT company can do if the market becomes bad. So the, ultimately, the company does not lose. It is the people who work there lose, but probably the company does not lose because they always bring down the cost of the people. A lot of people are available at low cost today. They may send a person who is getting 1 lakh and instead they employ two people at 50,000 rupees, 25,000 each. So the company is not going to lose. And with more people work from home and everybody needs a laptop, everybody needs a data card, everybody needs everything. Today, I think the IT sector is going to do something well. At least the margin of safety is quite high because it's written down badly. And the top six or seven companies have a lot of cash with them. And these six or seven companies don't have any debt, no leveraging. And the price to earning ratio is very, very low. A couple of other sectors which we can discuss, but we are running short of time. With this, I would like to conclude by saying that be cautious in the market. Don't miss out. Have a staggered investment. And in frontline stocks, don't look at penny stocks or don't look at multi-baggers in the space of small cap right now at this point of time. Maybe 3 months down the line, you can look at it even at a slightly higher valuation. So take a look at it. And a lot of mergers and acquisitions are going to take place. A same sector where people are dying, there will be another set of people who are doing extremely well with a lot of cash will try to acquire that at a throwaway price at a bargain. So a lot of mergers and acquisitions are going to take place and people are going to pump in quite a lot of money into certain sectors. Things are not all that bad as we think or all that rosy as we think. It is somewhere in between and only a cautious approach can save the investor at this point of time. Thank you. Thank you, Sundar.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Nagappan. Thanks for the wonderful presentation. There are quite a few questions coming up in YouTube. And probably people who are connected live through Zoom, they may also prefer to ask some questions. Shankarji, first I'll throw the floor to the people who are connected through Zoom so that they can ask their questions. Individuals can ask the questions. In the meanwhile, Mauli can give a list of questions which have been posted through the YouTube to you so that you'll be ready with the list. Before that, let people who are connected through Zoom, whoever wants to ask that question.
Yeah. Can I answer one question? One question.
Yeah, please.
Yeah. There is an interesting question from someone from Singapore. It says that should we further restrict FIIs to prevent a crash like this in the future? Has it caused overvaluation of scrips which could have been prevented? Probably has taken a lead from what I mentioned in 2019, the market went up to 28 PE because of FIIs pumping in a lot of money and now it has crashed because FIIs are withdrawing money. I don't think that will be a good idea because we do need FDI and FPI, foreign portfolio investors, quite a lot. Without them, it is very difficult. Market will not have this kind of a depth and width and breadth. All these things are not possible without them. Think about an India in 1992, what we famous popularly call as Harshad Mehta period, with 20 plus stock exchanges or volumes, ADTO, what we call as average daily turnover. ADTO was only 200 crores per day. Today, with only two stock exchanges, our daily average turnover in cash market is 25,000 to 30,000 crores or much more than that. And if you include derivative, it turns into several lakh crores, 20 lakh crore, 30 lakh crore per day. So this is possible because of FIIs. Yes, agree that probably this has led to excessive liquidity and because of which excessive speculation. But enough checks and balances are there in the market today. The only way to prevent this kind of thing happening is not by banning FII, but more local people participating into the market. Unless otherwise more local people participate into the market, I don't think we can tackle this problem of market crashing because of FII going out or market going up because FII coming in. This can be tackled only with local people pumping in quite a lot of money into the equity.
I'm throwing it open to people who are connected through Zoom. They can raise their hand And Shankarji, you can unmute those specific people so that they can pose their questions.
Yeah. See, first, thank you very much, Mr. K. T. Jagannathan, Mr. Nagapan, and Sundar. I just taken three questions from there. The first question was, somebody had asked, do you think government can reduce the tax and other charges will improve? Definitely not. This is not the time where already government is spending a lot of money on the subsidies and etc. So by reducing tax, maybe in the long, short run, we'll be able to overcome. But in the long run, I don't think the reduction of tax is the one of the solutions. The second question is the time frame. Generally, in any life cycle of any particular industry, unless it is highly capital intensive, like with turnkey projects, it is not more than 9 or 12 months. So I strongly feel by 2021 May or March, things should be good. That is the last quarter of this current financial year, that is 2021, people should be able to do well. So I don't find this as any great thing. If you are more than this, as Mr. Nagapan was saying, this work from home culture has also improved the quality of working, because if you are in working in office, you will always tend to say we'll do it tomorrow, there, later. But now the time is, as the commuting time is reduced, and more so you are easily assessed on your deliverables. So whether you are physically present or not, if you are delivering, you are taken care, especially in IT enabled services company. So working from home will give more opportunities for people, and will also, the efficiency will increase, especially in cities like Mumbai and Pune, where people have to travel for work for an hour, 6 or 7 hours of work, they have to travel almost 3 to 4 hours. So this will also improve the efficiency. And another question was, why is that the people have to migrate? This is one question. It's because it's all self-made. See, most of the places where the people work from other states are basically in construction industry. One greatest plus point is you take the guy from other sector, other state, he is in the site. So he literally works from dawn to dusk, 6 o'clock to 6 o'clock. And if it is an electrical work, he even works till 8:39. And there is no weekend or there is no holiday. So the only way for us is, as long as, and not only that, it is quite cheap when compared to the people available in the local area. We can always see during our long holidays, people don't, especially in construction industry. So the question of people coming from other states and working is definitely a good sign. And it also says people from this part of the country are going to other for better jobs. So I don't think people working from other states is an hindrance here.
There is one question. Can I answer that?
Yeah, please.
There is one question about pharma companies, whether we can invest in pharma companies. I don't think anyone would have asked this question about a year back or a year and a half back. But now when the news is there out and the company, the everything is discounted, then now we are thinking of this kind of a question. See, now everybody knows that the pharma companies are, you know, everybody think that the pharma companies are going to do very well, there is going to be a big demand. Remember that about a month and a half back, many people also told me that the hospitals are going to do very well. But now all of them know that hospitals are not doing very well. In fact, on the contrary, hospitals are doing pretty bad because of COVID. The occupancy levels have come down drastically in many private hospitals. Not many people are coming there, or even if they come, they're not admitting for various reasons, safety, security reasons. So hospitals are, you know, they are in deep trouble right now. Nobody would touch hospitals at this point of time. But then pharma companies, the valuations have gone up substantially in the last one and a half months. And they were all a good buy about a year back, 2 years back, but not now anymore. Maybe a good trade. Somebody who's trading with a strict stop loss probably can look at many of those pharma companies. It's not a joke. The fact of the matter, if you look at pharma companies, is that many of my friends will wait for US FDA rejecting any of those particular products. And then when that happens, the next 2 days, the stock price will come down, or the particular company stock price will come down. And the third day they go and buy, invariably within 1 year, they are able to see 30 to 40% profit. And this has happened many times repeatedly again and again. So the right time to buy pharma is only when there is a negative news about that particular sector. Today, there is a positive news about that sector because of the negative news on the health side on coronavirus. So normally speaking, I will not look at it. And then unless otherwise, they are looking at making any import replacement. We are talking about supplying to the world, but all of you, I mean, we all know that we are importing quite a lot of APIs, quite a lot of things from China. We are still dependent on China. And we keep talking about innovation. What is more needed is not innovation now, actually import replacement. Now that is what is the priority. Innovation can always come later or work side by side, but then what is very, very relevant right now is import replacement, because we can be taken for a ride, we can be threatened by a country which manufactures such a product where we are totally dependent on them. It has happened in the last 1 month, 1.5 months, you would have seen right from an equipment to everything, now we have to depend on someone else. So that is what is the priority. So I will not touch pharma companies. I am a little bit a contrarian, so I may be wrong. I look at something like IT or maybe 2-3 to 6 months down the line, banking sector probably, or NBFCs. And I want to ask this question to KT Jagannathan. KTJ is there online? Yeah, is there. See, one of our the viewer, he has asked a question that whether the government should make it tax-free or reduce the tax. Shankar tried to answer it also, but then on the contrary, if you look at it, today, I think today or yesterday, Saudi Arabia, or one of the countries there in the Middle East, has tripled the VAT. Value added tax has been increased by 3 times. So they quote oil price crashing and other things. So that this is the only way for the government to raise. And in India too, we have seen that the toll rates have gone up. So in such a time when the public expectation or the mood is that government is going to give concession, things are happening to the contrary, not only in India, world over. Now, how do you look at it? Why do they do this? What will be the effect of this? Is KTJ there?
Yeah, he's there. He has unmuted.
Okay.
You were saying why do they tax the fuel? That's what you are asking.
Why do they increase the tax at this point of time when there is a crisis going on? Globally, they are increasing the tax. Many countries, you know, like Saudi. Today, I saw that they have tripled the VAT, value-added tax. 3 times they have increased it. And India too, they have increased the toll, they have increased the tax on petrol. Okay, petrol price is not increased, but the tax is increased. Ultimately, its effect is the same. So why would governments world over or many governments do this when during a time of crisis, they may think that to raise the resources, but is it going to work with the economy not picking up? Is it the right thing to do, or is it like one of the viewers has asked, that is it better to reduce the tax so that demand is created, or what is your view on?
No, but the other aspect of it is, you know, the fuel tax is the significant contributor to the state exchequer and the national exchequer, you know. But then if you don't get that revenue, I mean, the point is, you know, if you don't get the revenue, but how do they fund? Like, then you want the money to be transferred to the migrant labor, you want the money to be transferred to some people who are to tide over the lockdown. I mean, the point is, you know, there is always an argument that, you know, if you give that, you know, but how do we, as a government also runs, you know, they have to pay the salaries, they have to do all that and take care of that. How do they make the money? Somewhere along they have to make money. So if you ask the same question, why do they open the liquor shops, you know? So liquor shop also the same problem. On the one hand, you give DBS or whatever to them. On the other hand, you open the liquor shop and take the money away that way. See, the point is, I don't know. This is it. How do I say that, you know? It's pretty so balance between social and your government financial needs, and I would put it like that. That's my I'm not an economist, but I'm just, my reading is that, you know, you need to balance it, you know. So it's a crazy for the governments to open up the liquor shop now, you know. But you know what, I'm also learning, you know, from different sources that, you know, It has a different kind of a problem at home. So in the sense, the domestic violence have increased, and also there is a theory that, you know, how do we contain that social problem there? So you open it up, maybe like that, you know, all that, you know, you need to. I mean, we are always looking at from one perspective. As a government, they will have to look at it from that. So how do they get the government get the? What are the other revenue options for the government? Government needs some money to pay salaries and pay everything also. So that's what I feel, you know. So. See, like taxing the fuel, it's very regressive, as you know that. And so in the sense, you know, it adds up everywhere. It's adds up to the price on all prices, you know. Ultimately, the consumers are paying, you know, in very, very, very many different forms at each stage, you know. It's worse than the probably income tax, I would put it like that, you know. See, indirect tax is always a regressive tax, you know, but we don't feel it. It's like a coronavirus, you know, nobody feels it, you know. But whereas income tax, you see it, you know, the impact of it. This is chipping away, you know. So that's a problem, you know.
I think it is the same, Mr. Agarwal. See, one is, first of all, the other industry will take some time for the money to come. Liquor industry is something that the money can come directly. And secondly, if you see in Tamil Nadu, only 4% of the money comes from the liquor, and baki sab comes from the other industries. It is not that by opening out your liquor industry, it is going to generate the revenue a lot. And thirdly, with respect to the petrol, the amount of subsidies given to the people the last 5 to 6 years is so enormous, they will have to compensate that. They have been given so much subsidy to people, especially in the LPG segment, which was not there. So even that needs to be compensated. So it is not only prices reduced. We have a lot of backlogs which needs to cover up. And in respect to GST, liquor, that's where directly the state gets the money. Otherwise, the new GST infrastructure, the money goes to center, and from center it has to come. Whereas in case of liquor, it comes directly to the state's revenue. Maybe that could be the reason.
Okay, I think we'll take one final question and close it. Somebody has asked about the banking shares, banking sector. Does it, you know, look very attractive or valuation-wise? Is it not, I mean, true that the banking sector or the shares of the banking sector were looking very attractive for the last few years, actually, but in spite of, a lot of problems associated with them? And the problems associated with them are the reason, very reason being them always trading at single digit PE. Most of them were trading at single digit PE, except a few private sector banks. So in my opinion, we should have recovered in another 6 to 8 months, probably if things had gone right and not this much of this problem has come in. But now that this problem has come in, there will be a genuine failure. There we can expect a few bankruptcies or people filing for bankruptcy or going to NCLT. And there could be a misuse of this situation by a few people who can always take advantage of this situation to and try to default or do certain things. So either way, if you look at it, next 3 months, the moratorium is given. So even if there is an NPA, it's not going to be reflected as an NPA because of the moratorium if they've opted for it. It will go to SMA1, SMA2, and this categorization will take place. And suddenly after Q2, after September, we'll start seeing probably a lot of NPA. And just before that, I don't think the markets or the banking stocks are going to go up until then. A lot of mergers and acquisitions might take place. A lot of takeovers will happen. Government itself will merge a few stronger banks with weaker banks or weaker banks with stronger banks, vice versa. So I think it makes sense unless otherwise you are a very high risk. It is to wait on the sidelines and observe and then buy later, or go for the market leader in private sector who has got who will gobble up the other banks in the days to come at a throwaway price. So these are the options available. So you have to be cautious, right? Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for the opportunity.
Can I add just one question? There was one of the viewers have asked. Could you refer to Chinese-based circular economy? Any of the panelists?
Sorry?
Could you refer to?
Yeah. It is asked by from Vivo 1919. One person has asked.
Chinese-based circular economy. If anybody can throw on some light on that.
I don't understand the question.
No, Jagannathan.
I'm not following what is that?
The question is, they are asking, is there a circular economy based out of China?
No, that is
something similar to circular trading.
Sundar, Chinese economy means you use any product to the fullest extent and recycle it and don't go for again for alternative. Suppose that generally happens, that means if any iron industry, you ensure every part of the iron. Suppose you make a crankshaft, wherever from the mold a lot of things are coming, you don't prohibit to use it within the organization so that you don't
make them
the scrap. Instead, reuse it wherever possible.
Make them more dependent on China.
Not more on China. It is meaning, suppose, like what happens in the sugarcane industry, nothing goes out. Everything is used thoroughly. Your byproduct here is like sugarcane industry guy setting up a power industry with the bagasse, so that at the end of the day, whatever product you manufacture, you use it to the fullest extent. In short, you use your own byproduct industry. Sundar, you are there? Sundar?
Yes.
Yeah, I think we can conclude.
I'm there.
If you are done, you have any more questions? Otherwise. We can have same time next week, maybe a different topic with the other. How shall I speak? Any questions? I think Sundar is caught on the line. So any more questions, or you can if you can send the questions in the YouTube, take it. Maybe we can meet same time.
Yes.
Thank you all for your participation.
Thank you, madam.
Thanks. A special thanks to Mr. Jagannathan. Thanks, Madhavan. And all participants and all customers and all staff. Thanks a lot. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. Nagappan, sir, and KTJ, sir. Mr. Santosh.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you all.
Thanks, sir.